Welcome to another edition of Grace Under Pressure, where my guest today is Irvin Nugent. LinkedIn Live show focuses on what we too often dismiss as the soft stuff, the caring, the compassion, the commitment we exert toward others. And when you do it as a leader, it means you pull people together for common cause and you energize the organization. Irvin Nugent, it is a pleasure to have you on the show. Welcome.
John, thank you so much. It's an honor and privilege. I'm excited.
Great. I want to tell everyone about you. I love your bio. You say that you believe that leadership development is a journey from the inside out, and you have a PhD, and you teach emotional intelligence, and you help people develop it. And you've been doing this working with senior leaders for more than 15 years. After you got your PhD, you did a coaching program at my alma mater, Georgetown. So we shout out Hoya Saxa there. You work in challenging business environments. You've worked extensively with executives and emerging leaders. But you have a very different background than any coach I work in, because you're a native of Northern Ireland. Mm-hmm. And you bring to your work a rich and varied experience. You grew up during a time of sectarian violence that tore the country apart. And you're passionate about helping leaders bridge the gap, the distrust, mistrust. And few would know it as well as someone who has lived through such tragic times. So it is an honor to have you on here. Irvin, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So before we delve right into your background, I want to jump into, we're 1 year plus into the pandemic. What are you noticing with your clients, or what are you hearing? So,
you know, it's interesting, John. What I've begun to notice is a new phase is emerging. And I think some of my clients are actively now trying to imagine what's it going to look like as we come out. And actually, some of them in more personal conversations are, you know, I'm afraid that I'm going to lose some of the things that I've enjoyed so much, and some of the things that I've learned about myself and other ways that I've come to be. And I don't want to go back to the old me. I don't want to go back to the old reality. And so I think people are, and I think it's such a rich conversation about how do we bring forth what we've learned, the good things, and carry it on. So I think that's such a great and rich conversation.
That is great. And I'm glad you mentioned that. I will publicly mention that that's kind of the themes of a brand new book I have coming in 6 weeks' time, called Grace Notes, Leading in an Upside Down World. But you have a terrific book that its title grabbed me, Leadership Lessons from the Pub. So how can a pub be a place for teachers? So
it's a great question. You know, one of the things I reflect upon the clients that I work with, a theme that comes up time and time again is, how do we make our workplaces a place where people want to go, where they want to commit, where people feel they belong? And of course, the impact of that, et cetera. And then as I thought about that, I said, you know what? There's an institution that has been around for hundreds of years, and it attracts people. People want to go there. They call it their local. And there is a commitment there. And what's really interesting, the dynamic of the pub as well, is that people are vulnerable there. People share. People create community. It's a place where you don't go and you have to have all this impression management. You go with your warts and your all, and you can tell the stories, what's happened, and people will laugh at you. They'll cry with you. And I said, here is a learning lab for leadership, because what's happening in this space is something profound that I think leaders can learn from. So the book, the genesis of the book actually was that, the conversations I heard, and then the reality of what the pub just does so well.
You grew up in what the Irish call the time of the troubles. What did you learn from that experience that's relevant to us now? It's probably another book, but I'm going to.
Yeah. So I grew up in a society that, for all intents and purposes, had broken down and had turned tribal. And people just believed in their narrative, their story. They'd forgot how to listen, and that had turned violent. And I think I learned the danger of tribalism. I think I learned the danger of only hanging out with people who say the same things, believe the same things, and never are challenged. And I think, you know, we're in an episode in our own country where at times, unfortunately, I think we're losing the power to talk to each other. We're losing the power to hold a space for difference, to honor that, and that it doesn't mean we have to hate each other. We can just agree to disagree and have conversations. And I think for me, that lesson, how do we create a place for difference? How do we create a place for disagreement? And how do we carry that forward is something that's instilled in me from the time of the Troubles.
Great. And you have a very, very personal connection to this. And if I can interpolate, something I would say that came from your father, Irvin grew up in a pub, or above a pub, I say. and was also a barman, and among many other things. But your father believed in inviting people no matter where they came from, which was not a popular stance in the 60s and 70s in Northern Ireland.
So. Yeah, I mean, in Northern Ireland, it was a Catholic pub or a Protestant pub. It just wasn't a pub. And my father had really, you know, and John, I've begun to appreciate the older I get, that I didn't really appreciate it as a younger person, but really he invited everyone. It doesn't matter what side of the divide you came, if you came in peace, and you had so the bar was known as a mixed place and place where people, and it was one of the few institutions where that actually happened, because everywhere else was segregated.
Okay. Well, let's delve into the lessons from leadership lessons of the pub and the Irish revere stories. And one of the reasons we love the Irish is because they're such grand storytellers, be it the poets, the novelists, whatever. So what is it that storytelling means to you personally? And I know you teach it. So
the Irish have an amazing word for a storyteller. It's the Irish, the Gaelic word is a Seanachie, and it actually, it's difficult to translate, but one of the ways you can translate it is the keeper of the tradition. And I love that. I love that stories are a way that we carry on our tradition, what's important, what is valuable to us. And I think story does that in a way because it creates emotional connection in a way that nothing else can. And so I think the Irish, we've gone through, we like to say we've gone through 800 years of difficulties. And part of that is, you know, story has been central to the Irish experience of how do you keep the tradition. Pubs grew up as places in people's homes where Seanachie would come, they would tell stories. So there's this rich tradition. And I love that, especially as leadership and in business, the leader, you know, is the person called to be the keeper of the tradition, the keeper of the story.
What a wonderful thing. Now, as you well know from your coaching and your executive experience, one of the things that permeates every organization, and not always unhelpfully, is conflict. Mm-hmm. And you talk about something, knowing your own conflict story. What does mm-hmm. that mean, Irvin?
So I like to say everyone has a relationship with conflict. And it's important to know it. And I think, you know, a great sign of emotional intelligence is knowing that. And so in other words, it's important to know, does conflict disturb you? Do you move into conflict or move away from it? And part of that is your experience of growing up, the messages that you received. And I think, you know, you're not determined to live by that, but it's important to know it. So it's important to know that if there's conflict happening, that your initial reaction may be to step away when really what you need to do is to step in, or your initial reaction may be to step in and really what you need to do is just step back and breathe a little bit. So I think that's important.
I once worked with an organization that that said, we're too nice around here. And I did a step back and I go, well, I know a lot of people that would shade places with you. And they go, no. And so I kind of think about it. What it really is, it's called the disease of nice, which is mm-hmm. conflict avoidance. So yes. What's the problem with that, Irvin?
Well, the problem with that is that human relationships have all types of discussions. And at times, discussions are not always nice. At times, discussions have to get into important areas that are uncomfortable. And at times, it is conflict because there is disagreement. And if we don't discuss that, then it threatens having resentment, that people go about going, you know, that I resent because I never said something, or you made a decision, I didn't say that. And I think, you know, unless we have healthy conflict can be healthy and can be unhealthy, but unless we have healthy conflict, I think it's almost impossible to get everyone on board.
You mentioned a key word here, and I think it's certainly true now in our only in our culture, and it's the word resentment. It's very evident. So if you hear the word, someone struggling with resentment, what do you say? I mean, we want to say let it go, but do you have a tip or insight into that, Irvin?
So there's a definition that I love about resentment. Resentment is a request that was never made. And I love that because when you dig below the resentment, very often what you get to the core about it is some underlying feelings about something that have never really been verbalized or presented. And so what I always, when I work with clients and they bring this up, I always say, well, what needs to be said? What wasn't said? And I said, you know, put it on the table. And I think that's really important because very often where resentment is coming from is something that was never said. And this people say, well, you should know that. Well, no, people don't intuitively always know. You have to actually say what it is you're looking for.
Now, getting into my grace theme, which I'll touch on occasionally, what role does forgiveness play in resentment?
So that's a really powerful question. I think forgiveness does. I think there are times when we hold on to things and we have a choice about that. And I think forgiveness is the choice to let go, to voluntarily let go, not expecting anything in return. And I think it is a powerful gift to ourselves.
That's wonderful. And that's what I would say. That's grace in action. Yeah. Something that you know well, very well. So, but now it's getting back to everyday, well, this is everyday life, but overcoming a conflict, adversity requires something which is very important. And I think we've all discovered it. And it's the concept of resilience. Do you teach it? And what do we learn from it?
Yeah, I mean, resilience is. I mean, I think we're living like we're spending the last year now in times when we are very triggered, and when we're dealing with constant change, we're dealing with a situation which is unpredictable. So I think resilience is incredibly important. You know, innately as human beings, we're built to survive, but I think we also have to recognize that there are elements that really can help us be more resilient. And I point to two. One is just the physiological. So it's do we have the self-awareness to take care of ourselves physiologically, everything from sleep, food, et cetera, and then psychologically. You know, are we attending to our psychological needs? And I think in this place, hope and optimism are incredibly important. You know, are we focused on the possibility of what can happen and a future rather than the past? And that's certainly something that got me through the troubles in Northern Ireland.
Great. Do you think Northern Ireland today is a resilient culture?
Yes. So I think there is also a dark side to resilience, John, as well. I think at times when you grow up in very conflictual settings, I think you can get you bury at times some feelings just to get on with life because I need to survive. But there has to be a moment when you revisit that. And I think a dark side can be that you don't, and those begin to impact. But I think it is a resilient community. I think we have reinvented ourselves, and I think we've never lost hope that things can be different.
Well, speaking of hope, a little dovetail, and the reason that you're on this show is because you were introduced to me by Dr. Helen Reese, who is, I'll say, the world expert in empathy, and I know you work with her. So tell us about the work you do with Helen or in your own practice about empathy.
Well, specifically with Helen at the moment, we're actually doing some really powerful work with police departments, and we're looking at the role of emotional intelligence and empathy as well in helping people recognize the power of empathy to have more productive and powerful conversations. That when we have this ability to connect with people on an emotional level, it can transform relationships and give us information, data that otherwise we would not get. And it has the power as well to truly create greater influence and connection. And so we can use the power of empathy for that. I think we can get a lot more with a teaspoon of honey than with vinegar.
Well, as you know, we are working with the police. We are ravaged by a scourge of gun violence versus unarmed Black men perpetrated by police. And the key word that we often hear in the aftermath is de-escalation. What role does empathy play in de-escalation?
It's essential because, you know, the problem is when you go into a situation, you have heightened emotions, you've got bias, you've got expectations of what's going to happen. If we're not able to read another person, if we're not able to notice the signs, and then it can easily spiral out of control. And, you know, be that mental health situations, et cetera, lots of these different tense situations. And empathy can help go into a situation and that could go down one route of escalating tension, anger, et cetera, into a de-escalation and almost like a what I like to call a transformer down to downgrade the tension that's there. It can be powerful and lead to life-saving results.
Great. Now, I'm going to delve here just because it's such a powerful topic and just top of mind now. Police have a very, very difficult job. I mean, any interaction could turn deadly. Sadly, God forbid, they don't, but it could. And so police must have to arm themselves mentally to deal with this. So how do police come to an understanding that empathy is not me being weak? So
I always say the way I like to introduce it is, what's the end result we're looking for? And if the end result is looking for, because, you know, a lot of police work is not necessarily around kind of violent crime as well, but it is to serve the citizens and it is to get to a result where we're able to resolve a situation. And so if keeping that in mind, what's going to get us there? And so often empathy will help us recognize what's at the core of the problem and will also help us have conversations that really get to resolution instead of escalating a situation.
Right. As you're describing this, I'm thinking a key concept to empathy is really respect. And I came to an understanding of respect is a sense of open-heartedness, being open-minded about folks, which is very easy to say, but we have our biases, we have our prejudices, and it enables us to get past them. Am I correct in that, Irvin?
I think so too. I think, you know, there's no such thing as an unbiased person. So the idea that, you know, I don't have bias is bogus. But the point is, it's the awareness of what bias might I have, including, say, for example, like I feel very sorry for police at times because they're responding to a call who has come in from a person who themselves have biases. So even from the very beginning, the initial call to first responders, it could be full of bias as well. They could be given bogus information that has come in. So all of that, you know, to be able to hold that in a stage, knowing that the information I have may not be accurate, but I have to prepare for it in case it is. So it's a very difficult situation.
Now, when you speak empathy, do police regard it as a form of weakness, or how does the light bulb go on?
I have to say the trainings that we've done so far, I've been very impressed. I have met men and women who are hungry for information, who want to do the best they possibly can, and who want to change the dynamics if they can. So that's been my experience so far.
Great. And I'm thinking of this because one of the things you talk about, and I love it, I hadn't heard it quite expressed this way, but it's so true. Emotions are contagious. Might empathy be contagious?
Absolutely. So, yes, it is. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, if there's one thing we've known about the pandemic is that this invisible disease, which can be caught, and our emotions are caught as well. And that's why emotions are so powerful. And I think empathy as well can be caught when we have these mirror neurons that are responding to another person and they take us to a place potentially of compassion and empathy.
I always like to say that empathy for a leader is a little bit different, and see how you respond with your work of people in authority like police is empathy is that ability to feel another one's discomfort or pain or suffering or whatever. But and leadership empathy to me is and that commitment to make it better. Would you agree or disagree with that, Irvin?
I think so. Yes. I think if I just add one little clause at the end would be if that's in the best interest of the organization, so yeah, to make it better. But I think at the very least to be able to acknowledge the pain and suffering of persons, even if you may think that it's not just, but to just to acknowledge that is critical for a leader.
Right. And I'm glad you added that because that's what leadership is all about. Leaders are required to make the decisions about the good of the organization. Sometimes, sadly, people get left behind in that, but it's the holistic view from a leadership perspective. Personal dynamic is different. So you have an interesting concept, and it's in your book, Leadership Lessons from the Pub, which is the thin place. Mm. Tell us about the thin place. I want to say the thin man, but it's actually a thin place.
So the Irish have a very rich spirituality, and part of Celtic spirituality is the belief that there are places which are sacred places where the veil between heaven and earth is thin, and there is a presence in that place that can be physically felt and spiritually felt and emotionally felt. And I love that image, and I apply it as well to our leadership presence. I think, you know, when people come into our presence, there should be a quality about our presence that people should be able to feel. That people, I mean, how wonderful and graceful that if a person leaves a conversation with a leader saying, you know what, that person was totally engaged with me. I felt different. I felt they were with me. And so often that doesn't happen.
You know, so often hearing you say that, and I loved how you linked it to presence, because presence is one of those things that leaders have in different ways. Mm-hmm. And so often we hear this about leaders that so-and-so, when I met so-and-so, he or she made me feel as if I were the only person there. Yeah. I think our president at the moment has that ability. And it's very powerful.
No. Absolutely. Yeah. And just this ability, you know, it's Maya Angelou's kind of famous quote, you know, people will forget what you say, people will forget what you did, but they will never forget how you made them feel. And what a motto for leadership that is.
Without question. So, getting back to the example of your father, and I know you have a good story to tell us as we conclude, but I'm not quite there yet. You say that publicans create an environment. A publican is a pub owner or runs the pub, and a safe environment for patrons. Big concept with all of us now, Irvin, is something that our colleague Amy Edmondson pioneered, and that's psychological safety. What's the link there?
Oh, huge link. So I think good pubs, what good pubs do well, if you ever go to a pub in Ireland and you sit down, be prepared. You will not sit alone. Someone will sit next to you and you can get annoyed. But really what's happening is that they're widening the circle and you're being brought in. And so there's an understanding in the pub that goes without saying is that you can share anything, that you can be vulnerable, that you can share your warts, and people will laugh with you, not at you. And people will probably put their arm around you, give you some advice. So there is this amazing space that's created that really has a real link to psychological safety, that basically, you know, this whole notion that no one's pointing out your wrongs, that no one's making fun of you, that no one is out for you. And the good pubs create that space. And it's tremendously important.
That's such a powerful concept. I don't like think I've revealed this on the show yet, but I told you in my early 20s, I had the opportunity to be in London. And I actually worked in a pub for on and off for a few years. It was a part-time job. And so I know something of what you speak. It wasn't an Irish pub, but a little different, the English. But yes, and you said something fascinating about psychological safety. Laugh with you, not at you. Mm-hmm. And that's such a positive thing, is it not?
Oh, totally. Yeah. But so often, you know, I always say, you know, a sign of a highly emotional, intelligent person is someone with humor. And what I mean by humor is it's not vindictive. It doesn't bring people down, but it can bring a situation and laugh at it. And so something bad happens to you, you know, together we can laugh at the situation. I don't need to laugh at you. I can laugh at this because, you know, as my mother used to say, there go I, but for the grace of God, you know, all of us, you know, are prone to these as well. And we can laugh at situations. There's a great saying, John, that if Ireland didn't have pubs, it would need to triple its population of psychiatrists and psychologists.
That's a good one. So, yeah, and I have to laugh because there's an old saying, and I'm a great fan of Jewish humor, Yiddish humor, and so much of the stories, it comes from oppression. Which the Irish have been oppressed so often. And it's a way of striking out and asserting one's humanity, if you will. And but the sense of that, one of my things from Hollywood days was life is hard. Life is easy. Comedy's hard.
Yeah, that's so true. Okay.
You have one concept I want to talk about, and it's linked to emotion. It's called your trigger print. What is that?
So, you know, everyone has a fingerprint. It's unique. And everyone has a trigger print. And so what a trigger print is, those are the things that emotionally trigger us. Some of it's formed by evolution. And so it's common. But all of us have unique circumstances, unique upbringings, unique experience, etc. And what triggers me is going to be different from what triggers you. And the more self-aware we are of that, the more able we are to manage it. And the more able we're managed it, the more then we're able to navigate meetings, navigate decisions, and realizing what's happening. So I think knowing your trigger print is incredibly important.
I like that. There's the word trigger point or triggers. Marshall Goldsmith has talked about that in his book Triggers. And that's momentary, but you're talking about the holistic sense of understanding where you came from. And am I correct in that?
Absolutely, yes. Understanding it, because very often, you know, once you explore, it's great exploration, because once you begin to explore why am I emotionally triggered, normally what's beneath that is a value that's being violated. Something you hold important that someone has stepped on, etc. And the more you explore that, it's just rich so it is in self-understanding.
Oh, that's great. And it's a powerful topic. So sadly, we are coming close to the end of our show. And I always ask all of our guests to tell us a story of grace and something. And I know you have a rich story to share with us, Irvin. So please do.
Yeah. So as we mentioned, I grew up in a pub, and when I was six, my parents had been out shopping, and our residence was above the pub. And unfortunately, one night, two IRA gunmen came and they placed an explosive in the pub. They gave us a warning of 5 minutes. My father was able to run up the stairs, clear people out. I was the last. I was sleeping. He was able to grab me. We ran down the stairs out the door, and the pub blew up. And literally, we lost everything, just our clothes and our back. But that's the tragedy. My father's response is what's graceful. And so he promised that he would build again. And 1 week after the bombing, he had managed to get a tent. He'd managed to get furniture. He'd managed to get some drink. And if you'd been there, you know, 1 week later, on one side was the burning embers, or these the smoky embers of the pub, with the worst of humanity. And here was singing and dancing and drinking and laughter and story, the best of humanity. And it led to an experience where we lived in a trailer for a year. And although my parents are deceased, I have four sisters still, and the bonds that were created was something beautiful. So, you know, out of tragedy and disaster, there is always grace. And for me, that's an inspiration. My father's just an inspiration for the ability to really build from anything.
Great. And that is you open your book, Leadership Lessons from the Pub, with that story, which you tell very eloquently and very powerfully. And so thank you. So, Irvin, how can people find you?
Go to my website. It's my own name, Irvin Nugent, IRVINENUGENT.com. And happy to have you there. Explore. There's lots of free resources and information.
Any free beer? No.
Soon, I had to soon.
Ask a joke. Sorry. You've been so gracious, and what I do, just throw something at you. Anyway, Urban, we will put that your website in the notes. You've been a terrific and gracious guest to me, and it's been an honor to speak to you. So with that, we'll go out. Thank you.
Thank you, John.